Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us today on Perspectives. We will hear from Mobile's new fire chief. Mobile Fire and Rescue Department has a long history, and it's more than 135 years of being an organized, paid professional fire department. Only a handful of men have served as fire chief. In fact, they've had only 17 since 1888. Fire Chief Johnny Morris's appointment is also an historic one in the annals of the Mobile Fire and Rescue Department. We'll hear his thoughts on that today on Perspectives. Meantime, Mobile Fire and Rescue's history is long, extremely interesting, and amazing. More than 200 years ago in 1819, the Mobile community started organizing itself to protect its residents, their lives, and property. The port city was first protected by organized volunteer fire companies. The Creole Steam Fire Company No. 1 is believed to be the first in April of 1819, and followed closely by the Neptune Engine Fire Company No. 2. Now, in 1838, the Mobile Fire Department Association was formed from six existing volunteer companies. Laws and regulations were made to govern the association. Then, 50 years later, in 1888, after a disagreement over funding, then-Mayor Joseph C. Rich, he terminated the agreement with the Volunteer Association. So, on September 1st, 1888, Mobile's professional fire department was organized and was officially operating. Creole No. 1 and many of the former volunteers had stepped up to offer their services for the new department. Today, 135 years later, MFRD has the accreditations and national accolades of one of the nation's top fire departments. Our guest today is Chief Johnny Morris. He is Mobile Fire and Rescue Department's fire chief. Now, Chief Morris was officially appointed on Tuesday, October 31st of 2023. The more than 30-year veteran is only, as mentioned, the 17th chief since the department's first, Matthew Sloan, in 1888. Well, after a quick break this morning, we'll talk with Mobile's fire chief, Johnny Morris. He's a veteran fireman, as mentioned, of more than 33 years of service with the department. We'll hear Chief Morris's thoughts about his new job, the direction he wants to take the department, and what changes he'd like to see at MFRD. Perspectives continues in just a moment. Welcome back this morning. Our very special guest, Chief Johnny Morris. He, as mentioned, is Mobile Fire and Rescue Department's new fire chief. We thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you for being here.
We know we're talking several different things that we want to talk about today. Had a chance to chat a little bit before the interview. Let's talk about the beginnings for you, because you got out of the Marine Corps.
Yes, sir.
And came back, and you were thinking about law enforcement as a career, but you were able to do something before you went to the police department.
Right.
And it changed your life forever, because you've been now more than 33 years.
Yes, sir.
As a fireman.
Well, it all started. When I wanted to be a police officer, and never forget going down to the Mobile County Personnel Board to sign up for the job. I signed up for to be a police officer, and this lady behind the counter, she said, "Well, I'm gonna sign you up for being a fireman too." And I was like, "I don't know anything about being a fireman, but okay, you know, because I wanted a good job." And so the fire department called me, went through the interview process and went through the hiring process, and actually started training. And one day while in training, PD was going to hire me, and I asked the question and said, "Well, tell me your work schedule."
Okay.
Because by that time, I had been in training. I met with the guys, and it was just like being in the military. We had camaraderie, we had brotherhood. We competed. We were young. We all had fun together. And I said, "Well, on this side, we work one day and off 2 days, and you guys work what?" I stayed with us, and that was my beginning love for the fire department. I loved because, like I said, the teamwork aspect, and I grew to love this department.
When you were coming back from Marine Corps, had you been in law enforcement in the Marines, or?
No, sir. Okay. I was a radio operator.
Okay.
Worked with the SCAMP unit, remote sensors.
Uh-huh.
But at the same time, funny story, I got in reserves.
Okay.
And so when I left, I hired onto the fire department. Right as I finished training, I got deployed to the Gulf War.
Oh, my goodness. This is 1990, right?
1990.
Okay.
And I came back, and I didn't miss a beat. I fell back in love with it all over again. I didn't change careers. I just stuck with it because I really enjoyed it.
Now, you mentioned in your biographical information the fact that you remember passing by a fire station in your neighborhood. So you had a little, interest about what's going on there?
Well, I knew it was a fire station there, right around the corner from where we used to live, where my parents still live there. And I would hear every now and then see the truck passing by, and I would walk passing there, going to the park or going to the corner store. And I never really knew anything about it. Didn't meet any firemen. Didn't engage. They didn't engage me. I didn't engage them. Uh-huh. But growing up, 18 years of my life, I knew where the fire department was, the fire station but never had occasion to go in. Never did that at all.
And so from 1990 until now, you have been in the midst of it all. When you look back on those 33 years, what's one of the most memorable things you can share with us that you think has made you to become who you are today as the fire chief?
I guess the most memorable thing is the mentorship that I was given. I had other members of the job, and they gave me valuable advice. And that was the biggest thing I tried to keep in mind. 33 years, I have a lot of calls, and I have a few calls with every different emotion that I can remember. But I think the best thing I get, somebody mentored me. Mm-hmm. I was given great advice. Some of the older guys that retired from here, some of the guys that's still on here now, I received just great advice. And my thing is, I have a certain respect for everybody. And once somebody takes the time to show me something or teach me something or tell me something, I keep that in mind and I use it. And I'm so thankful with that, and then the wisdom I think God has given me, it prepared me for this position. The experience, the education, and I guess the life lessons as well. And like I said, I've been a chief officer over 20 years. So I've seen a lot and been in a lot of situations. And I think that prepared me for fire chief. Now, I have to go tell the record, I never really planned my career to be a fire chief. Mm-hmm. I knew I wanted to be a chief officer because I wanted to be lead. I wanted to have an impact. I wanted to what we call put my thumbprint on this job, and I wanted to help people. Not outside the station on calls and at the station. I've always tried to help people. But when the opportunity came for me to promote through the ranks, mm-hmm. When the opportunity was I guess I got the opportunity to become the fire chief, I was ready.
Right. When you look back on the 33 years, any close calls?
Several. Especially when you're on the fire. Every firefighter that's in the field today, a lot of people don't understand it, but every time that bell hits, you are actually literally putting your life on the line. You know why? Because you get on that fire truck or that ladder truck, mm-hmm. and you're going code 3 to a response. You could be in a wreck.
Right.
Something could happen before you even get to the scene.
And we lost one of our neighborhood firemen a few years ago on Airport Boulevard.
Yes, that was my brother, yes. So when that bell hits, every firefighter on the street right now, they do a selfless job. They put their life on the job every time that bell's hit. Every medic, every guy that hits that truck. So, yes, you have to think 33 years of every time we left the station. Sometimes returning to the station.
Right.
We had an incident where a crew was assaulted returning to the station.
Mm.
Yes. So a lot of people don't think of that way, but we know it.
Right.
That's why we have policies and procedures in place so we can do it safely.
I guess one of the things you've probably seen also is a change over during your career of where evaluating the time in service, because so many firemen were dying right after they retired, and that was not something that is good for morale either.
Yeah, firemen love this job. Every now and then, like any other job, they may not speak positively about it, but they love it because they don't go anywhere. This job is a special job, and we're looking for people that can help us do this job. But at the same time, we do realize, even the recruits of people mm-hmm. we're trying to hire, this job wasn't meant for everybody.
Right.
I mean, like I told you a long time ago, my fire chief told me many, many years ago, this is a thankless job. Your job is to help people's life get better. Mm. Their situation that they're in, their emergency situation that they're in, to them is highlighted, and is like the world has come to an end. Our job is to make sure their problems are solved. Our job is to make life a little bit better for them when they call us.
Mm. I was looking at some of the research and the history about fire service in Mobile, and one of the things it said back in prior to 1819 and from that point forward of the volunteer service, there was expectations of almost every able-bodied man to do his part in being a part of the fire volunteerism to make sure that they were able to save buildings and save lives.
Right.
So it was sort of something that all of us would have been involved with back
in
the day.
Yes, sir. We all would have been a part of that bucket brigade.
Right, right.
Yes, sir. Somebody was going to have to train the horses and feed the horses. And when fire broke out in those old cities, yeah, everybody, the bell would ring, and all able-bodied persons would help put that fire out.
We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about some of the things that you see at the stations and with the people and some of the plans that you have. And I know that recruitment is one of the big things that you're going to make sure during your, at this point, in office as chief, going to make sure that people understand that we are looking for good folk.
Yes, sir.
All right. Chief Johnny Morris, he is Mobile's new fire chief, and we're talking today on Perspectives. We've got more for you in just a minute. Welcome back. We're talking with Mobile's new fire chief, Johnny Morris Jr. And of course, we're talking about some of the things that helped him become who he is today as the new fire chief. More than 33 years of service, and fell in love with it when you got involved. And of course, in sharing and hearing from you, you still have a great love for this office. Now, one of the things we were talking about, all the history aspect and the Creole department, I think 1961, they hired the first black fireman at the department. Right. And you are here in 2023, the department's first black fire chief. What are your thoughts on that? Anything that really hits you, or you're kind of like, let's get things done here?
Well, no, it's very humbling.
Okay.
It's very humbling because I remember when these two guys, the first black chiefs, period, first black chief officer, I remember that. I remember the first black fire marshal. I remember the first black deputy chief, assistant chief.
So you were on board when all those happened?
When all that took place.
Wow.
And when they made it, I feel like I made it.
Right.
So being the first African-American or black chief, I am so humbled. I'm so excited because I realize I didn't do it by myself. I'm glad that the mayor and his staff saw confidence in me to give me this opportunity. I'm so grateful, like I told you earlier, that the mentors I've had, because I don't want to say it as a cliche, but I'm standing on their shoulders. Mm-hmm. I'm standing on their backs because they allowed me, they helped me to get to this point. So I represent them. I represent our whole department. And I want to do well with it. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give all of me that I have, and I want to be positive. We're going to be nice, and we're going to do a good job. So. Has it hit me yet? It really hadn't hit me yet.
Okay.
But at the same time, I am. I'm about business, and I'm about doing. I'm about serving, and I'm so excited.
Now, when you first received the news that you had been selected, what was your reaction and response?
it was very, very, that feeling inside, like, wow. Mm-hmm. I can't say they or him, is me now.
Right, right.
And so I thought about my parents. I thought about what they would say. I thought about my wife. I thought about my children. What would they say? But at the same time, I was like, well, you know what? That 5 minutes over, it's time to get to work. It's time to reassess the fire department. It's time to do some transitioning.
Right.
Because it is about business.
Are your mom and dad both here?
They still living.
Oh, that's great. I'm sure
they are excited
for them. Yeah,
they are excited. I thought about them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So getting to work, making things happen. What are some of the things that you want to tackle? You know, one of the things that you all are addressing now is the annexation. You've got some of that, I guess, was already in your area of coverage, but now it's seriously, it's a part of your city limits now.
We are still expanding, want to expand our services, the newly areas that we picked up. We are a gold standard fire department, and that's not going to end or stop. We're going to expand to those new areas. Of course, with the infrastructure has been expanded, the personnel and the staffing, and that's what we're working on right now. So the same standard that you guys have been used to, those new areas coming in, they're going to have it as well.
And that saves them insurance money, right?
It's going to save them insurance money because we're ISO rated number one. Yes,
now,
sir.
Are you going to have to build any new fire stations to have your response time available?
Right now, we have that in the works planning projections right now. We're still looking at it. But in the meantime, we are still offering those same services. Our response times is a challenge, but the service that we provide is still top-notch.
When you look at these accreditations, do you have to renew them, or how does that
work?
We
renew them every 3 to 5 years.
Okay.
We renew them every 5 years.
Okay. So when you look at some of the things that you want to see that in your career you may have said, well, if I ever get a chance to implement certain things, what are some of those that you want to share?
Well, the biggest thing is be more. I've been telling everybody, and a lot of firemen, they've been doing it, but we're going to come out with a policy. We want to be more community engaged. We want to get out in the community more. It's going to start at a small phase, and then we're going to expand. Because right now, because we are a first-class fire department, I want the community to embrace us like we embrace them every time that bell hits. I want them to embrace us knowing that when they call us, they get a top-notch organization to come help them. But I want us to get out nursing homes, to ball games, to the park, engage in schools. We want to partner with schools because we are first responders. We're firefighters, but we're also mentors. We're also ambassadors of the city, and I love that. So my thing is I want to get us out in the community more. And number two, the biggest thing is I want our recruitment efforts to step up. We're running so many classes, and I want and our attrition rate is getting to the point where we're trying to keep that at a positive deal. So
and when you talk about attrition, you were telling me earlier that
retirement,
you got a lot of people that are at that retirement age now.
At the retirement age, and it takes a lot to replace everybody we're losing. We're losing some good people with a lot of experience. And to do that, we got to get new people to replace them.
Now, you have one class that we just covered, graduated, and you're talking about another one that's sort of following suit. How did you make that happen?
Normally, we run classes back to back. We'll run a class for 20 weeks, and then we give our training officers about a month break, and then we run another class. This time, we didn't do that. We staggered started them. We started one class, I want to say, back in September. And when they did part one of our 20-week training class, and when they went to the second part, we started another class right behind them. So we had two classes going on at the same time.
And the one that just graduated is one of the largest you've had in a few years, right?
We graduated, I want to say, what, 27, 28. The next class is probably going to have about the same amount. They're going to graduate, I think, sometime March, April. And then that, we're going to take a break and look and see where we are. Because we're expecting anywhere from 10 to 15 retirements the first part of the year. And once we assess where we're at, then we'll start probably another training class probably in the fall.
Quickly, give us an idea of what kind of person you're looking for.
First of all, we're looking for somebody with a service heart. We're looking for that person that want to serve others and make somebody else's life a little bit better. We'll train you for everything else. We need somebody that can think on their feet. We need somebody that wants to do well. We're not looking for couch potatoes. We're looking for somebody that's self-driven. We're looking for somebody that has the aptitude to learn new things. We're looking for people that's physically fit because this job, you have to be physical. And we're looking for everybody that fits that bill. Now, we're very inclusive. So we're not taking anybody off the page. We're including anybody. If you want to be part of Mobile Fire and Rescue Department, We have people for you to contact. We got recruiters. We have people that do us a fine job of helping gaining employment for these people. That's what we're looking for.
I love the soundbite we have from one of the guys talking about the physical aspect of how high he was up on a ladder and then going up and down the RSA tower steps.
Yeah, will we train you for all of that? But for my instructors, I have the best trained officers in the world. But only thing that we're looking for is that person say, you know what, I'm not afraid. I don't know how, train me, and we'll do it. We'll do it.
Chief, we got about 30 seconds. You want to leave a word with everyone who might be watching today and they're thinking about that same thing happened to you and they say, okay, right, let's check it out.
Yeah. I just want to let you know that I've been here over 30 years. It's one of the best jobs I ever had. And I want you to know that the people I serve, the people I represent, are some of the finest people nationwide. Brothers and sisters, men and women on this job, sometimes they don't worry about the pay. Sometimes they don't worry about the conditions. The only thing they care about is helping and making a difference in people's lives. And I think that makes me so proud to be their chief, because they do care. They, no matter the situation or circumstances, that bell hit, guess what? No matter how they're feeling, what they have at home in their personal life, right, no matter what they have going on, they're going to respond and they're going to do a first-class job when they get there.
Ready to go.
And so, again, I'm just so grateful to represent them.
All right. Fire Chief Johnny Morris, Jr., we thank you for joining us today.
Thank you
for
having
conversation.
Me.
And we hope that those who are wanting more information, here's some information. The main fire number to call, of course, the non-emergency communication number, you see it there. And most importantly, the recruiting information phone number, 251-554-2298. You see the website as well as the other information there if you want to reach out to find out more. Well, we thank you, of course, for joining us here today on Perspectives. We've got many more episodes for you to see on our webpage, and you've got more things to do this week. Have a super week.